Hello, and welcome to the virtual Yale University Art Gallery. My name is Stephanie Wiles, the Henry J. Heinz II Director. I welcome you to our third lecture of a four-part lecture and conversation series, Pablo Picasso at Yale, delivered by John Walsh. In this series, John explores the life and work of the most revolutionary and prolific artist of the 20th century, focusing specifically on important works by Picasso, present in the Yale University Art Gallery's collection, and weaving them into a broader global framework. In the two previous lectures, John introduced us to a young Picasso in Paris, his work with Braque, and his still lifes. This week's lecture, Cubism, Picasso, and the Human Figure, will explore lovers, bathers, mythological creatures, all rich material for Picasso's expressive interpretations of the human figure. John Walsh is an art historian, curator, museum director, and educator. He graduated from Yale College in 1961 and earned his master's and doctorate from Columbia University. John has worked at the Frick Collection, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and served as the director of the Getty Museum for 17 years. He has taught at Barnard College, Columbia, Harvard, and now part-time at Yale. Walsh's commitment to the power of art and close looking and to nurturing aspiring scholars has benefited students, the gallery, and the Yale and New Haven community immeasurably. We are grateful for his participation in this lecture series despite these challenging times. This series is sponsored by the Martin A. Ryerson Lectureship Fund. Throughout March, we will release a lecture on the gallery's YouTube channel each Thursday at 12:30 p.m. The lecture will remain on YouTube, and you can watch it at your leisure. Each lecture will be followed by a live conversation with John, which we will host on Zoom on Fridays at 12:30 p.m. Tomorrow, March 19th, John will be joined by Keely Orgeman, the Seymour H. Knox, Jr., Associate Curator of Modern and Contemporary Art here at the Yale University Art Gallery. We invite you to bring your comments and questions from this YouTube lecture to the Zoom conversation tomorrow at 12:30 p.m. Registration is required. Thank you so much for joining us today. And now I'll open it up to John for his third lecture in this series, Cubism, Picasso, and the Human Figure.
Stephanie, thank you very much. Today, in this third lecture, we pick up the thread of the first two, which have led us to Picasso's Cubism. Last time, we followed his evolution as a still life painter up through his Cubist phase and a bit beyond. Today, we'll do the same with his figure painting. And I'll begin with a short recap of his early career with the emphasis on figures. We saw him as a hugely gifted young artist in Spain, academically trained in drawing and painting the human figure. He joined the avant-garde of painters and writers in Barcelona. And then in 1900, he was drawn to Paris, where he finally settled permanently in 1904. He had immediate success in Paris with brightly colored scenes of nightlife and the more raffish class of Paris society. He was spotted by critics as a rising star, and he was cheeky enough to paint the self-portrait at the left and moody and sensitive enough, or maybe self-dramatizing, to see himself as ascetic on the right. He was drawn to the lives of the down and out in Barcelona and Paris. He painted them to exemplify how virtue went unrewarded in an indifferent world that was willing to let them starve. He was terrifically productive. Picasso's attention to moral allegory and his self-absorption were behind his first major project. This painting that he entitled rather grandly at the age of 22, Life, La Vie. It started autobiographically with drawings of himself as the troubled young man in the middle. And then after the suicide of his best friend, who killed himself in despair over a failed love affair, Picasso replaced his own head with his friend's. His sympathy for the struggling classes drew him to circus performers and other entertainers on the fringes of society. Here at the right, he puts them in an empty wilderness. His studies of anatomy are reflected in the Michelangelo-like physique of the man at the left, resting heavily on a big block and observing a slender young performer balancing, unwittingly acting out the truth of how precarious life is going to be. The whole troupe of entertainers at the right was Picasso's first large exhibition piece and his masterpiece of the period. They're silently waiting and watching in a directionless sense, state of anomie that Picasso presents as an allegory of modern life. Picasso's model for these early figure pieces is, more than anybody, Paul Cézanne. He took his cue from Cézanne's bather and painted an adolescent advancing confidently into his future. The contrast with Cézanne's hesitant young man is revealing. Picasso shows his young man leading his horse without the benefit of reins. And he paints the horse head on, not easy to do. And any contemporary would have seen that Picasso was challenging the masters, in this case, Degas, who was still very much alive and working. But they might not have noticed that Picasso was also inspired by a Renaissance artist, in this case, Andrea Mantegna, four centuries earlier, whose Mercury and Pegasus are in the Louvre, where Picasso went often. At the same time, Picasso painted portraits of himself and his new friend, Gertrude Stein, the American writer, who conducted literary salons on Saturday. She and her brother Leo bought pictures by Picasso and Matisse and other avant-garde artists. And if these portraits have a strange and rather similar oval faces with strong outlines and big jaws, it's because Picasso had been smitten by archaic sculptures from Roman Spain that he'd been looking at, like the one at the top. He seems to recognize some more elemental aspect in them, something more timeless and distinctively different from the academic ideal he'd been taught. Something that could apply to living people, to Gertrude Stein, to himself, and at the bottom, to his companion at the time, Fernand Olivier, the woman in the drawing that's here at Yale. Picasso was soon onto a series of nudes that embody a striking new figural ideal. These are 5 feet high, with archaic faces and massive physiques, solid, firm on the ground. At the left, a pair of women, one of them drawing aside a curtain. It's not clear who they are or what they're doing. It's been suggested that they're preparing to present themselves to customers at a bordello. Just how strange Picasso's women are, you can see by looking at what his older contemporary Matisse has been doing with a nude model of far more familiar proportions. He poses her in a totally anti-academic way in a complex interior. Both Matisse and Picasso were keenly aware of Cézanne, the artist that they both admired more than any other, who died in 1906 and whose work was shown in a large exhibition before the end of the year. His young people populate a kind of new Eden, a golden age revived in a contemporary landscape. Picasso knew that Matisse and he were both carrying forward a great figural tradition of the Renaissance that Cézanne had inherited from Poussin, and they aspired to do that themselves, carrying it still farther forward into the modern age. Matisse's response to Cézanne's vision of freedom was to strew beautiful young people across a colorful landscape at leisure, unrestrained by inhibition, but assuming classical poses, minus strict conventions of scale and gravity. Picasso also took up the challenge, but in a totally unexpected way. He was drawn to another traditional fantasy in painting, the hothouse world inhabited by lounging concubines. This was a subject for many academic painters of the 19th century, most successfully Ingres. One of the best known of these is in the Louvre. As a warm-up for his picture, Picasso made this rather scruffy sketch on the left of a harem with a single, presumably satisfied client there on the ground, a projection, if ever there was one. It would have great consequences. Picasso made many, many drawings for a composition at the left that was going to show a brothel with five female employees and a sailor in the middle, who not incidentally looked a lot like Picasso in other drawings he made. At the far left, a medical student arrives, unannounced, carrying a skull in his arm, or in some versions of the composition, a book like the one you see. It seems to have been intended as an allegory of lust, the sailor, and prudence, the young doctor who's learned about venereal diseases. In this next drawing, the men are gone. The women are looking at you. You've become the potential customer. And that's the composition that he chooses to paint on a canvas 8 feet square, all spring and summer of 1907. The title it got from one of Picasso's friends, and which he didn't like, meant the young ladies of the red light district of Barcelona. The picture shows women in a bordello somewhere and had another title, the philosophical brothel. The table is set for you there at the bottom, literally and figuratively. In the last lecture, we looked at the still life on that table and we traced its consequences for cubism for the next couple of years. But today, I want to look at the figures and the setting that he's given them. Let's look first at the woman who's second from left, with her one arm raised high, elbow up. The pose comes down from Greek antiquity and was used most conspicuously by Ingres in a Venus that everybody knew in the Louvre. Now here's an oil sketch evidently intended for the same figure by Picasso. For the figure we're talking about with the elbow raised high, but in a very peculiar stance with her weight on one leg and her other leg across it. It's been argued that Picasso had intended his sketch for a reclining figure like a Renaissance Venus seen from above, and that he used it instead for the standing woman. So in turning her 90 degrees, why wouldn't he have altered it to make her stand up believably like the woman next to her? This is just one of many acts of defiance by Picasso of convention. He's rejecting the convention of unity of style or vantage point or perspective. Other women here introduce other styles and other cultures, other eras in time. In the pose of the woman at the far left, from Egyptian and Greek antiquity, and in the two shocking heads at the right, West Africa The small figure at the top belonged to Matisse, who showed it to Picasso, introduced him to Congolese sculpture. Picasso saw much more in the ethnographic museum that summer and visited studios of artists who collected this material. And next to it at the top right is one of several small wood carvings that Picasso himself made at the time. Although Picasso eliminated the sailor and the medical student, who represented two aspects of his own life, self-indulgence and caution, I think there's no doubt that Picasso himself is still in the picture. The women with mask heads at the right are scary and powerful in the way that he imagined African sculptures were intended to be. The size of the women also, and the brash kind of convention with you, kind of confrontation with you, is the challenge. They're inviting you, they're daring you to run the risk of joining them. Picasso was superstitious, and as a regular brothel goer, he had a great fear of infection. He put the five of them in a claustrophobic non-space and filled the voids in between them with something that looks hazardous, like slabs of broken glass. But both his technique and his imagery break through to new territory. Picasso left the picture in the studio, showed it to a small number of visitors, but it was only exhibited in public 9 years later, after which it was rolled up and not sold for 8 more years. Picasso's work spins off in many directions from the demoiselle. At the left, you see several of a series of bathers in a forest with poses that echo the demoiselle. Then in the middle, there's no bathing, no forest, but possibly a dance. And then at the right, surprisingly, a group with tremendous blocky, weighty forms. Everything that had been fluent and ballet-like in the middle version is fixed and carved like statuary. But now in the colors of fired terracotta, like the two nudes at the left of a couple of years earlier. In between is one of the curious woodland creatures who's less blocky than her sisters, but schematized in her own way, with shoulders dramatically discontinuous and with paddle feet galumphing forward out of an enchanted forest. Here's Matisse in the same year. How innocent and free these dancers seem. This is a large sketch that Matisse did for the Russian collector who was buying Picasso's too, Sergei Shukin. The utterly weightless girls dance in a world that's been reduced to the pure green of grass and the pure blue of sky. Picasso was trying to imagine ways to represent figures that had some greater power than Matisse's cutouts, and also waiting and wanting to test some fresh ways of rendering the mechanics of the body. He conceives this bather shading her eyes at the beach as a kind of colorless mannequin. Her shoulder joints are articulated with a flange to turn in, and her buttocks and hips are a massive swivel. In the face, there's a suggestive device that we'll see Picasso use later on again with a metaphorical intention. He gives her both a bright profile view and a shadowed head-on view with just a line to divide them. So far, I've been talking about figures by Picasso that have been schematized and have premonitions of cubism, but are still some ways away from cubism. does. It wasn't with figures, but with landscapes and still lives that Braque and Picasso first arrived at what we can call cubism, as we saw in the first two lectures. Braque and Picasso exchanging ideas and imposing a more radical kind of geometry on inanimate things. The impetus came at the beginning from Braque, as you've seen, from pictures he painted in the south of France that got him a bad review in 1908 because, according to the critic, he reduces everything to generate geometrical schemes, to cubes. Braque was accentuating the jumble of the buildings and in the middle, allowing forms and space to leak out of their contours and merge with others. And in the following year, Picasso turned his more severe mind to picturing the village in the Catalan highlands where he was living. He began to paint still lives as well. He accentuated the geometries of the houses and the walls and reassembled them. He used a similar method to reduce glasses and bottles on the right and tables and curtains to caricatured forms that he then scattered and reorganized. Picasso subjected his partner, Fernand Olivier, to a similar process. It's a close-up. He makes her head bigger than life. He puts it on shoulders and a neck that resemble a structure, something like the buildings of the town. But he preserves the graceful curve of her pose. She seems to have been assembled in a machine shop, and what would be flesh tones are brass and pewter. Her eyes are stylized into tilted windows, maybe a sly nod at the ancient cliche that eyes are the windows to the soul. Her forehead becomes wedge-like, and her hair a massive turban of anthracite. The background is more conventional, a bed, a table with fruit that appears to spill into the bed, and green curtains. There's space, but it's compressed by the steep perspective of the table and by the curtain and by the trick of putting trios of parallel diagonals in three different places, at the top left, way at the back, on the table, and then close to us at the lower right. Things are much more recognizable in either this landscape or still life. Picasso's not as ruthlessly determined to make us work at identifying what we're looking at. Later that year, he painted Fernand in several more versions, and he got his hands on some clay. He adapted the painted head to an actual three dimensions, making a less severe, more curvilinear version than he cast in bronze. Picasso returned to full-length figures and the problem of treating them with cubist techniques. He made drawings to explore. Here's the bather again that he painted in a stylized pre-cubist way. And next to it, this ink drawing here at Yale. In it, there's a similar pose, and you can make out a similar sort of structural basics. The emphasis on joints, a play of rounded forms in the middle, suggesting hips and buttocks, and legs in an almost balletic pose. But these two are highly abstracted and unlikely to be enjoyable for most people to look at. The charcoal drawing next to it has a decisive zigzag that helps us imagine, if we don't actually see, legs and torso and shoulders, neck and head, all with the sort of exoskeleton of straight lines and arcs. The painting at the far left in the National Gallery stands 6 feet high and is more complicated than the drawing, though just about as indecipherable. One scholar who studied all the related drawings to the picture concluded that the painting represents a woman holding a child, but that is not the general view. You can point to head, breast, hip, and maybe a few more bits, but because you know where those things are rather than their resemblance to the actual parts, he's reduced the palette to earth colors, which removes the forms even farther from our experience. Here's Picasso's portrait of Ambroise Vollard at the age of 44. I'd like to slow down again and look for just a minute. Vollard was Picasso's first dealer, who launched him in Paris with a show of 64 of his works. Vollard was a shrewd talent spotter, as he demonstrated by taking on Cézanne. Picasso had his ups and downs with him. Anybody who knew Vollard would recognize him from the features that Picasso accentuates: a wide, high forehead, sort of bald dome of a head, a broad nose, bearded peaked eyebrows, and a wide mouth. He's looking down, but there are no hands or reading matter. Only a few other bits are hinted at. Shoulders, suggested by a few of the many diagonals, a glimmer of white shirt, a button. He's surrounded by floating planes of gray that don't depict atmosphere or empty space, but fill the void with an active, shifting commotion of forms. It's as though the presence of the man, the mental energy of the man, were activating all of this, making it visible. This is a device that Vincent van Gogh had used for a number of portraits, including this one. It's a visual equivalent of his intellect at work. Van Gogh's restless pattern is as different as it can be. It stays in the background. But I think, like Picasso's Vollard, it's not merely a pattern. It's meant to suggest, I think, the mind and the spirit, Vollard's capacity for complex thought of all kinds. And of course, the artists are both displaying their own capacity here, their own virtuosity, as great artists have done for centuries before. Picasso knew this great portrait of Vollard, painted by the finest artist of his generation. And I think he recognized Cézanne's floating patches of paint in the background and in Vollard's suit, and even in his face, recognized them as advanced for the time, 10 years earlier, and was encouraged to try something more extreme in his new idiom. Picasso's gray shards aren't describing anything, though. They're not shorthand, but I think they're autonomous, fully abstract. Cézanne's patches are suggestive, and they require the viewer to let them resolve into form. Picasso painted portraits of two more art dealers in his circle. At the right, this is the German Wilhelm Ude, a lot more legible than Vollard. Now all gray, with a face narrower than it was in real life, the better to give him that pursed-lipped, pinched, sort of fastidious expression that it's said he often wore. There are some touches of wit. He wears a stiff, starched wing collar, and there's a similar shape on his forehead, but it's tightly shut, maybe signaling the opposite of an open mind. And next to him, opposite his mouth, is a drawer pull of the kind that you would find in an office, but the drawer is shut. Picasso's portrait of another of his dealers, Daniel Henry Kahnweiler, is more complicated. He introduces a wash of white over the gray and brown image, something like smoke or fog. The head has swept back hair, a long nose, a smile that reads as contentment, satisfaction maybe, and it goes with the watch chain and Kahnweiler's clasped hands at the bottom. All parts of conventional formulas for portraits. Kahnweiler was habitually impeccably dressed and did indeed look like something like the photographs that we have him. If you notice that this one has the drawing here at the left of a standing nude that you saw a few minutes ago. Back a year to the time of the Vollard portrait. Just one other figure piece, a nude model with a mandolin. The instrument is only a little deformed, but the player quite a lot. Half her face and her shoulder appear to have been cleaved off and parts of her chest displaced. In other words, Picasso has deformed exactly the things that had been beautiful to look at the many in the many 19th century pictures of that subject, especially by Corot, whose paintings were enormously admired by painters and collectors. Picasso does away with the Italian peasant costume, together with a sentimental flavor, but what remains is an emblem of ideal harmony that we're forced to confront as a construction of the artist, not at all a slice of life. Summer 1910 was a time of intense experiment with this subject by Braque and Picasso, one hopscotching the other by turns. Braque at the far left is farther along in dissolving the form of the mandolin, and her upper body is hard to make out, but her arms and the instrument are there. The painted surface is more vigorous, and it's held together by a grid of black lines. Picasso's in the middle. He's gone much farther. He alludes to the zigzag structure of her pose, and there's a teasing bit of fingerboard suggested by the ladder in the lower middle. But the forms are bigger and much more boldly modeled in light and shade. Here, I'm going to put Picasso on pause for a moment and just introduce two early converts to Cubism who were drawn into the Braque-Picasso orbit at about this time. First there at the left is Picasso's countryman, Juan Gris, a former illustrator who shared studio space with Picasso in the Bateau Lavoir. His portrait of Picasso has a kind of cubism that's more systematic than Picasso's, with bigger planes, and his imagery is more accessible. His still lifes at this moment have an austere feeling, solemn, almost mystical. They're unified in their big patterns and a lot less puzzling. They introduce subtle flushes of color into their gray environments. And a few years later, Greece becomes a rival during Picasso's phase of colorful compositions, so-called synthetic cubism. This is the wonderful still life here at Yale. The other painter is Fernand Léger, who jumped in with both feet. Even though his subject here is nudes in a forest, he's hopelessly smitten with modern industrial progress, machines, speed. And right away, he's painting compositions with dynamic movement as different from Juan Gris and from Picasso, as you can imagine. And he too, within a couple of years, has also turned to color, but his imagery is still humans and machines in harmony. Now, back to Picasso in 1912. Picasso and Braque were moving towards an even more complex form of cubism applied to human figures. You can see this visitor to the Museum of Modern Art is keeping his distance from it. At the right, you recognize the still life of 2 years earlier that we discussed in the last lecture and we saw a moment ago. The painting he's looking at is this one, where for a lot of people, things get even harder. Let's just look at it again for a moment. Well, the questions that come naturally here are, what am I supposed to be seeing here? And if I can't tell, why should I be bothered with it? Sometimes there's an edge of suspicion. Are we being put on here? Is this a hoax by intellectuals to embarrass me? Well, right off, there isn't much to recognize here if you're looking for persons or things. But there's a lot going on. There's a big triangular form that takes up half the picture. We might suggest somebody playing an instrument. But we suspect that because we saw Picasso doing it earlier. Some figures of a closed hand in the middle, fingers. And above it, some vertical lines, like strings of an instrument. Over to the right, four more fingers pointing down, straight. Not so much in the middle that I can report. And at the bottom, there's a little treble clef and the words, "Ma Jolie." That was the title of a cabaret song, and also the nickname of Picasso's then mistress, Eva Gouel, who had succeeded Fernand Olivier, who'd departed in the meantime. Picasso had painted a dozen pictures with that title. So music is here, and love in words and symbols, minus the musician. Mainly what's here, and what really counts, is an engrossing painted surface to look at, full of forms that play with one another, forms that vibrate with the touch of this brush, forms that sometimes look opaque and sometimes translucent, horizontal lines and vertical lines that suggest forms, and also diagonals that in places create illusions of depth. At the left side, a succession of arcs rises up from the bottom to suggest something organic, and then seem to vanish behind more insistent dark forms. The forms are stacked on one another. I'm conscious of saying that I could be describing music, which we seldom expect to portray anything, but just to be sounds organized to give surprise and pleasure. In fact, music itself was undergoing changes in Paris that had a lot in common with Cubism and were often met with similar kinds of incomprehension. Some composers of the previous generation had already gone outside the traditions and methods of tonal writing. Claude Debussy devised a scale of whole tones that did away with the security of major and minor and created sequences of chords that didn't resolve in the expected way. In Debussy, traditional forward movement sometimes seems suspended and sometimes capable of going in any direction at all. The highly eccentric Erik Satie was writing short pieces for piano or small ensembles, like still lives, that had no bar lines, those regular divisions that structured time in traditional music. Satie wrote the music for Parade, a ballet for which Picasso designed Cubist costumes and sets with an orchestra that included foghorn and typewriters. The year before, Picasso painted Majoli, a ballet score by another brilliant foreigner, Igor Stravinsky, had its premiere in Paris, The Firebird, which had rhythms and chromatic colors in the orchestra that had not been heard before. And 3 years after that, in 1913, Stravinsky's much wilder, more explosive music for The Rite of Spring would create a sensation in Paris. Cubism and contemporary music drew upon similar ideas and reinforced each other. And poets and novelists in Paris were also part of this exchange. Picasso's friend Gertrude Stein and the far more ambitious James Joyce were making the English language perform in new ways. They kept the color and sense of words, but they often abandoned conventional sentences and syntax in favor of looser structures, freer intermingling of ideas and images and associations. Something very like the way our minds operate in reverie or free association. We're at the boundary of pure abstraction here. Boundary that Prak and Picasso also reached in still life, but we're at the boundary, not over it. Picasso rejected the idea of abstract art and always kept a foot on the ground of observable reality. One thing that helped keep Cubism on the near side of the boundary is the words that entered the picture, literally introduced by Braque, not Picasso, in this painting on the right of a painting of 1911. The letters and numbers that are stenciled on the surface. At the top, there's DBAL, short for Grand Bal, advertising a dance hall. And there are a couple of numbers down below, a few other letters at the upper left. Brock explained why. Being quite flat, he said, the letters enabled me to distinguish objects situated in space from those outside it. So they were reminders that the painting was an object in its own right, an autonomous thing, not a mirror of the world or an open window on it. This idea had consequences quite soon. After a trip with Braque to Le Havre, Picasso painted a picture that breaks out from the super cryptic, sober mode of the previous year. He uses bigger forms, uses more writing, and some patches painted to look like printed faux wood, which was an in-joke, an imitation of an imitation, and a bow to Braque, the discoverer of faux bois, you'll see in a moment, as an art material. There's a festive scroll at the bottom with a title. And color is back, a festive jolt of blue and maybe a bit of tricolor. In the previous lecture, we looked at Braque's discovery of pasted paper, papier collé, as it was baptized, and we saw how Picasso jumped right on it and used newspaper and wallpaper and sheet music, scrap paper, whatever paper was at hand, to invent a kind of collage that's still in use by artists and hobbyists and grade school teachers. Picasso's famous next move was an assemblage with real oilcloth printed with imitation chair caning on which he painted a still life. And the newspaper we recognized by the letters J-O-U, the beginning of journal, but now the letter U has slipped off the paper. Anyway, J-O-U, jou, could be jouet, a plaything, and the whole painting just a game. Apropos play, games, newspapers, cafes, fake materials, here's Picasso in the following year, assembling a caricature of a young man identified as a student by his great big beret. He's got a bottle in his arm and a silly grin on his face with eyebrows and mustache to match. The fake wood to the left is Cubist code for cafe. His newspaper doesn't have the usual flag at the top, J-O-U for journal. It just has the ending, U-R-N-A-L, urnal, which in French makes the same little joke. Sophomoric, you could say. But Picasso's Cubism has a last brilliant, colorful phase, awkwardly called synthetic cubism. Synthesizing would be more like it, if it mattered. Color is back. Together with revivals of Picasso's own past interests, like African art, and it has a kind of high-spirited mischief and sometimes jokey misogyny. Exhibit A is this 5-foot painting of his mistress, Eva Guel, she of Majoli. She sits in a purple tufted chair and holds a newspaper while partly displaying herself. Her small polygonal head and tiny features suggest that it's not intellect or personality that she's displaying. According to John Richardson, Picasso had seen a life-size portrait by Matisse of his wife sitting frontally in a chair. Here's the picture, and the picture by Matisse cost him a lot of struggle, and Picasso set out to do something in the same format, but with different results, to put it mildly. The study here at the far left shows that in place of Madame Matisse's attentive good manners, Picasso portrays Eva offering her body for him to lust after for our entertainment. The picture is extremely clever, and it seems to me a bad joke at best, and a mean-spirited, dirty joke at worst. Using cut-up colored paper for still lifes seems to have liberated Picasso as a figure painter, too. He made a series of large paintings imitating papier collé in their patterning and in their layering of flat planes. I say imitating because the pictures are entirely painted, and they're some of the most whimsical and joyous and witty things that Picasso ever made. The man here grips a smoking pipe over there at the lower right. He wears a derby and has a vest with buttons going all the way down. He's the image of self-satisfaction under this accumulation of patterns, kind of like the display of samples on the counter of a wallpaper shop. You know, his face has two sides, a bright side, where there's an eyebrow in the form of a palm frond, and a dark side with a displaced eye and ear. The last major work in this vein is the best known, the Harlequin of the following year, 6 feet high, and where the fun becomes serious. The stock Harlequin character had been a stand-in for Picasso himself for the past dozen years, an imaginary doppelganger. Harlequin, the performer, gets rewarded for his wit, but he remains an outsider. He's paid to caper around with a grin and entertain people, but offstage he's cultivating his dark side. His identity is unstable, like the flat easel-like forms behind him. He's present here twice, Picasso is, not only as Harlequin, but also in Picasso's own profile on the unfinished painting that he's carrying. Picasso called it the best thing he'd ever done. He's going to return in a few years in the same guise. The war had broken out in 1914, and life in Paris became more difficult for Picasso. Many of his friends, including Braque, had enlisted. But being a Spanish national, Picasso stayed in Paris and went on working. In 1915, his life underwent great changes. His mistress, Eva, died at the age of 30. He made friends in new circles, particularly in the Russian ballet company of Sergei Diaghilev, the Ballet Russe. At the left, you see Picasso, age 35, looking quite secure in front of the big painting you see in the middle. It's a high-spirited composition that we could never imagine represents a man, let alone a man leaning on a table, if it weren't for the two little eyes in the black patch near the top. The rest is an almost abstract patchwork of pattern and textiles. At the right, something completely different. Picasso never lost his ability to make accurate, realistic drawings. And here he does that with Vollard's, 6 years after his great Cubist portrait of him that you saw earlier. This kind of closet classicism on paper was just the beginning. Picasso was friends with the poet Jean Cocteau, and through him he met the impresario of the Ballet Russe, Diaghilev, who had Cocteau working on a new ballet, Parade. Picasso agreed to do the sets and costumes. You saw a couple of them just a minute ago. Picasso was drawn into the fashionable circle of supporters of the ballet, which had put on Stravinsky's Firebird in 1910 and The Rite of Spring in 1913. And very soon, Picasso was having an affair with one of the ballerinas, Olga Kolchova, and painting her picture in a classical revival style. And this led to a revival, full-on revival, of Picasso's interest in classical form, which he juggled while continuing with Cubist compositions like this one. Why not both styles, Picasso would ask. Why should I be expected to be consistent? Isn't consistency of style just another outworn convention? In the picture at the right, Picasso as Harlequin again. His face split into dark and light zones, the image of two-sided ambivalence, violin in one hand, music in the other. The song, by the way, Si Tu Veux, I think is probably the beautiful long love song by Massenet of the 1880s, Si Tu Veux Mignonne, And I imagine it was addressed to his bride, Olga, who had definite high bourgeois ideas about where and how they should live. Picasso tried out various non-cubist styles, even as he adapted cubist ideas for other purposes. At the top right is a short-lived exercise with super slender ballerinas in contemporary stretch suits that were daring at the time. Their poses parody classical Venuses and overly histrionic dance moves. And down below them, a pastoral with lethargic heavyweight lovers in saturated colors. At the top, you see Picasso's big project for the Ballet Parade in 1917. The choreography was by Leonid Massine, music by Satie, as you heard. The Picasso designed a curtain and the set in the middle, and costumes that included at the upper left two walking, talking cubist sculptures, not to mention the horse at the bottom. His work continued in the 1920s and on the same two separate tracks. The neoclassical Women at the Spring at the left was painted in the same period as the greatest of all figure pieces in the Cubist style at the right, The Three Musicians. Picasso not only needed an outlet for his skills as an academically trained artist, but he also wanted a place for himself in the great French classical tradition. He said at one point that when he was a child, he could draw like Raphael, but he had to teach himself how to draw like a child. I think he didn't want to be defined as a cubist, but to display his versatility. He painted Harlequin several times with live models in the neoclassical manner. In this case, doing an elaborate underdrawing with cross-hatching, a technique older than Dürer and Raphael, and a show of tremendous discipline. In some paintings, like the one in the middle, Picasso outlined and modeled the figures using academic techniques, but exaggerating their proportions. A few others at the right, he returned to classical proportions and made a large brush drawing on a prepared surface using pure outline, like a Greek vase painter. In other figure paintings, there's a grave inwardness, little color, gentle light. Picasso wasn't alone in this return to classical styles after World War I. He was part of a general regrouping for French artists and writers and composers who had participated in avant-garde literary and musical experiments before the war, Cubism being the best known. Picasso's friend Jean Cocteau published a book of essays in 1926 that gave it a name, Rappel à l'ordre, Return to Order. Picasso simply added classicism to his repertory to be used where and when it might be interesting to him or appropriate for the subject. I want to show you three examples of Picasso's versatility, and more than that, his ability to create so many strong and convincing images in such entirely different styles. By now, Picasso's left cubism behind, but not his appetite for exaggerating the human figure. I don't know another picture by anybody that celebrates the sheer absurdity of sexual attraction among human beings. It's a Syrian relief sculpture meets comic book artist. So should we be shocked that l'amour fou can make beasts out of us? When we witness an artist disclosing his own hot-blooded fantasies, should we be amused or embarrassed? Picasso spent a lot of time at the beach in the summer. Here are two products of the same year, 1929, when he was still married to his embittered Russian ballerina, but euphoric about his new younger lover. The swimmer is underwater, weightless, without substance, but with a healthy tan, and she moves with joyous freedom. The bather he conceives as a marble statue. He paints her standing alone on the beach in a ballet pose. He's entirely rearranged her body parts to suit his purposes, though, and he's placed her solitary figure against a cold, overcast sky. In the next lecture, we're going to look at Picasso's success at creating memorable images of important human events, both private and public. So in the meantime, please be well, and please join us if you can.